gathered today, just a number of announcements that I would like to kind of put forward for you. First of all, if you want to get your cell phones out and go ahead and check in on Facebook, remember we always make a donate, small donation to one of the local charities in the area, if you're doing that. Second of all, if you're looking through your bulletin, you're going to notice that the 12th annual fire event, that's not the one that took place over on 2nd Street. That's the one for religious education, Lutheran religious education in the area, is going to be taking place. Information on that is in your bulletins as well. Jamaica team meeting is going to be taking place tonight at 6 o'clock. There's information on that. And then we're going to get into a whole bunch of things that are related to Lent. Of course, Lent starts on March 1st. That's going to be the day of Ash Wednesday. That means that we're going to have our modified ICFU schedule that takes place on Wednesday night, because we're going to have Lenten evening worship services that will be each Wednesday evening at 7 o'clock as well. Except I'll remind you that on Ash Wednesday, that's the first weekend, March 1st, the first Wednesday in Lent, we will also have a 12:10 service that will take place on that day as well. But in regard to all of those things that will be taking place during Lent, what you're going to notice is that there's going to be a class that's going to be taking place, which is called It Takes a Village to Raise a Child. If you'd like to register for that, that way we would know how many people are going to be there, and we would know how many materials we need to order for that. Also, you will notice that there is going to be a knit, pray, crochet. It says it doesn't matter if you're just learning, a beginner or a professional. That should pretty much cover y'all. So if you're interested in that, and then there's going to be also one other class that's going to be taking place, and my wife Kim Remmers is going to be leading that, so she's going to go ahead and make an announcement about that.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Oh, really early. Last night when I said good evening, everybody just looked at me. Since probably mid-December, I was putting together something because I like to have something that I am working towards, and usually it's kind of my own thing during Lent. And this time, as I was trying to put it together, I thought, wouldn't this be great for anyone who kind of likes all different kinds of art forms? And so you may have seen the posters that have been up, Art in the Heart of Lent, and that's what I'm going to talk about. There are registration forms out there. There's also registration forms on the website. I think they got on the website. And it's on I know it's on Facebook if you want to register that way. Basically, it's a unique way to have some time to just think through Lent and your Lenten practice and Christian living. We're going to do things on prayer. We're going to do some things on Bible, how to put together a Bible kit so you can do your own little devotional time. We're going to have some liturgical dance. We're also, I don't know about you, but on Ash Wednesday, when I come in the evening, so it means within an hour it's gone. Because I go home, I wash it off. And so one of the art forms is going to be henna. And you don't have to do all the different things, but it is for two hours, and there's crafts and various things. The two things I really want to uplift are things that the whole congregation, you don't have to be part of just the classes on Sunday afternoons. One is Lent, through the Lens, and there are papers out there. And basically, each day through Lent, there is a theme or a word. And the first one would be ash or dust. And then there's also sacrifice, witness, follow. Now, I know we all kind of joke about the fact that my husband is not very computer literate, but even he takes a bazillion pictures with his camera. And that's basically what this is. You just think about that, and you see something, and you just take one little picture of it, and then you send it to this hashtag, which you can do through Facebook, Twitter, whatever you're on. And then we'll have this basically out there for everyone to see that faith, that our faith is being used daily as we go through Lent. The other thing is on the 19th of March, my theme is Take Up the Cross, and it's going to be our thing that we're doing for the 500 for March, which means we're kind of doing Lent and Reformation all in one. But we need to make 500 cards and stuff some little bags that are going to be then the next Sunday used for everyone to take out to the only and lonely. Meaning, basically, it's going to say something to the effect of, God meant you to have a hug today from First St. Paul's, and then a scripture verse, and we're going to be giving those out, meaning everybody, because I can't give out 500. But to make 500 of those, I'm going to need more hands than just mine and two others. So if you want to participate in just one thing that has to do with this, I really encourage you to think about the afternoon of March 19th so that we can get those 500 cards made so that we can fulfill our obligation or our, what we're doing for that month. Thank you.
Thank you. So the little pictures, you know how people call those selfies? I'm calling these lenties. What do you think? All right. There you go. And she was talking about how that would be one of the 500 things that we're going to be able to do, is we're going to be able to take things out to people who are shut-in or lonely or something like that, and you're going to have to figure out who some of those folks are, because we have a lot of shut-ins in this church, but we don't have 500. So consequently, that will be something where you can take them out to your friends and your neighbors when you're doing that as well. That will be the 500 for next month. Y'all remember what the 500 were for last month? Okay. What you don't know is what the 500 are for this month. But I became aware that there was a new hunger ministry that was going on in our town. It's called the United Harvest Mobile Pantry. Has anybody heard of it? Basically what it is that they have a number of different places that deliver food to different grocery stores or things like that, that when the expiration dates are not yet passed, but when they're getting close and they don't think that they're going to be able to sell all of those, they pack all of this stuff, but they put them in a truck, and two of the churches, the Methodist Church and the Presbyterian Church here in town, have kind of partnered up together. And what they're doing is that they are hiring one of those trucks to come in. And basically what happens is people get to go through and they get to kind of go shopping. But after they've demonstrated a need, and they can kind of go through and they can get all the food that they want. And here's the irony of the whole thing. In order to get that truck to come, in order to pay for the truck, and in order to pay for the driver for one afternoon, anybody have any idea of how much that costs?
$500.
$500. That's exactly right. $500 for the month on doing that. So consequently, we were thinking that how about during Lent we make sure that families in this community aren't hungry. So consequently, kind of like what we do at Christmas Eve. On Christmas Eve, we put some of the things out and we kind of announced that if everybody who went to church on Christmas Eve was able to give $1 that was in Adams County, we would be able to build one house for Habitat for Humanity, right? You know how we do that? Mm-hmm. Well, here's the deal. If all of us who are in church today give $1 on your way out, put it in one of these receptacles that are there, we can make sure that people in our town aren't hungry for 1 month. So on the way out, there's our 500 for this month, as we're celebrating 500 years of being Lutheran. There's our 500 for this month. It will go to the United Harvest Mobile Pantry, is what it's called. Will the congregation please stand? Peace of the Lord be with you all.
And also with you.
Please share that peace with one another.
Good morning.
Good morning.
I do have one other announcement, and that is, if you would like to thank Wendy for all the work that she did while she was here, there's a little reception that's going to be going on for her between the worship services and the land of cake and donuts. So, anyway, let's go ahead and continue with our worship service. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
God of all mercy and consolation, come to the help of your people, turning us from our sin to live for you alone. Give us the power of your Holy Spirit, that we may confess our sin, receive your forgiveness, and grow into the fullness of Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord.
Amen.
Let us confess our sin in the presence of God and of one another. Gracious God, have mercy
on us.
We confess that we have turned from you and given ourselves into the power of sin.
We are truly sorry and humbly repent.
In your compassion, forgive
us our sins, known and unknown, things we have done and things we have failed to do. Turn us again to you and uphold us by your Spirit, so that we may live and serve you in newness of life, through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord.
Amen.
In the mercy of Almighty God, Jesus Christ was given to die for us, and for his sake, God forgives us all our sins. As a called and ordained minister of the Church of Christ, and by his authority, I therefore declare to you the entire forgiveness of all your sins, in the name of the Father and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
We continue with the singing of the opening hymn, hymn number 564.
Liaison.
Lord, my Lord.
Holy God of compassion, you invite us into your way of forgiveness and peace. Lead us to love our enemies and transform our words and deeds to be like his, through whom we pray, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. Please be seated for the readings. The first reading is found on page 93 in the Pew Bibles. It is taken from Leviticus 19, verses 1 through 2, and verses 9 through 18. The Lord spoke to Moses, saying, "Speak to all the congregation of the people of Israel, and say to them, 'You shall be holy, for I, the Lord your God, am holy. When you reap the harvest of your land, you shall not reap to the very edges of your field, or gather the gleanings of your harvest. You shall not strip your vineyard bare, or gather the fallen grapes of your vineyard. You shall leave them for the poor and the alien. I am the Lord your God. You shall not steal, you shall not deal falsely, and you shall not lie to one another. And you shall not swear falsely by my name, profaning the Lord of your God. I am the Lord. You shall not defraud your neighbor, you shall not steal, and you shall not keep for yourself the wages of a laborer until morning. You shall not revile the deaf or put a stumbling block before the blind. You shall fear your God. I am the Lord. You shall not render an unjust judgment. You shall not be partial to the poor or defer to the great. With justice you shall judge your neighbor. You shall not go around as a slanderer among your people, and you shall not profit by the blood of your neighbor. I am the Lord. You shall not hate in your heart anyone of your kin. You shall reprove your neighbor, or you will incur guilt yourself. You shall not take vengeance or bear a grudge against any of your people, but you shall love your neighbor as yourself. I am the Lord." The second reading can be found on pages 927 to 928 of the Pew Bibles. It is taken from 1 Corinthians 3, verses 10 to 11 and 16 to 23. "According to the grace of God given to me, like a skilled master builder, I lay a foundation, and someone else is building on it. Each builder must choose with care how to build on it. For no one can lay any foundation other than the one that has been laid. That foundation is Jesus Christ. Do you not know that you are God's temple and that God's Spirit dwells in you? If anyone destroys God's temple, God will destroy that person. For God's temple is holy, and you are that temple. Do not deceive yourselves. If you think that you are wise in this age, you should become fools so that you may become wise. For the wisdom of this world is foolishness with God. For it is written, 'He catches the wise in their craftiness.' And again, 'The Lord knows the thoughts of the wise, that they are futile.' So let no one boast about human leaders, for all things are yours, whether Paul or Apollos or Cephas, or the world, or life, or death, or the present, or the future, all belong to you. And you belong to Christ, and Christ belongs to God." Here are the readings. Please rise for the gospel.
Continuing on the page 787 in the Bibles that are before you in the pew racks, I will be reading from the Gospel according to Matthew, the 5th chapter, beginning with the 38th verse.
Glory to you, Lord.
Jesus said to his disciples, You have heard that it was said, an eye for an eye and a tooth for a tooth. But I say to you, do not resist the evildoer. But if anyone strikes you on the right cheek, turn the other also. And if anyone wants to sue you and to take your coat, give your cloak as well. And if anyone forces you to go 1 mile, go also the second mile. Give to everyone who begs from you, and do not refuse anyone who wants to borrow from you. You have heard that it was said, you shall love your neighbor and hate your enemy. But I say to you, love your enemies and pray for those who persecute you, so that you may be children of your Father in heaven. For he makes his sun to rise on the evil and on the good, and sends rain on the righteous and on the unrighteous. For if you love those who love you, what reward do you have? Do not even tax collectors do the same? And if you greet only your brothers and sisters, what more are you doing than others? Do not even Gentiles do the same? Be perfect, therefore, as your heavenly Father is perfect. The Gospel of our Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
The hymn is number 772. Together. And when we get together, we still have tournaments where you have to draw names and you get there and you not only have a tournament where you establish the winner, but we actually have traveling trophies. that you have to bring back for the next time. So I don't know how many of you guys are familiar with Euchre, but like I said, we played it to win. All of that worked really well until my brother and my sister and I started to bring other people into the family. And we found out that not everybody plays cards like that. You see, Euchre is really a quick little game. It's kind of interesting in some of the rules that it has. In Euchre, you don't have a full deck. You only use the nine through the ace. You only have to take three out of the five tricks that are going to take place in every hand. There is trump that is called. You can tell your partner that they don't have to play along with you on some hands, and if you are able to take all of the tricks all by yourself against the two opponents, you get 4 points instead of one. If you keep your partner along and you take all of the tricks, then you get 2 points instead of one, but you're only required to take three out of each of the five tricks that are in each hand if you are going to win. Of course, if your opponents call, that means you can set them, and then you can take 2 points from them if you do it that way instead. Of course, you don't have to follow trump if you were there, but you have the option of following trump. The problem with trump is that it's a little bit like pitch, because the jack of the suit that's called in trump becomes the highest trump, and the jack of the same color becomes the second highest trump, so it's no longer its suit anymore. And then there's all of these little rules that you can add on how you're going to play. You can simply decide that you're going to play together, that you're going to have a no-trump hand, or that you're going to play stick the dealer, or you're going to play no ace, no face, or any of the things like that. And if you are lost right now in my talking about this, don't worry about it, because then you know how Dan and Paige and Kim felt when they joined our family. You see, I thought that the rules were plain. I thought that the rules were clear. I thought that the rules helped clarify what was going on in the hands and with the game, so that consequently, if you had your cards dealt and you knew what was going on, you could start to play in about two or three tricks into each hand. Sometimes you could simply throw your cards down and say, I have the rest of them, so we don't have to play this out. Let's go on and move to the next hand. And of course, if you do that with a bunch of people who don't understand the rules and are still struggling with that, that becomes very... Let's just say that it wasn't as clear. To Kim or to Paige or to Dan, who are the in-laws, or as they call themselves sometimes, the outlaws. For them it was hard. For them it was confusing. For them sometimes it could be frustrating. Now, if you understand how the rules for us were freeing, but if the rules for them were confusing, then you're probably going to have a better understanding of what I'm going to be talking about when I start talking today about the book of Leviticus. If you want to get a glimpse into how the people thought about Leviticus, you see, when I was playing cards, I viewed the rules of Euchre as a gift. I viewed the rules of Euchre as a gift. They kept us from fighting with one another. They kept things moving along in an orderly fashion. And because you knew the rules, you knew the rules. And not only did you get to go ahead and throw hands in early because you could see already how all of those things were going to be going on, once you knew the rules of the game, when the deal was out, you could look at your hand and you could understand that maybe in this hand I have a chance, and so I need to pay attention and I need to count trump and I need to make sure that I know what everybody's playing. And other times I could look at the hand and I could realize that I was just going to be along for the ride. And because that was the case, I didn't have to pay as close of attention. So then I could talk with people, and I could relate with people, and I could laugh, and that was especially helpful if the other people were trying to concentrate. But I could see that from the time because I knew the rules. And so the rules for me helped us to not only play, but to relate with one another. And we thought that they were a gift. If you talk to Kim and to Paige and to Dan, the way that they heard the rules when they were starting to play was we would tell them, no, you can't play that card now. No, you can't call that trump anymore. No, it's not your lead. No, it's not your deal. No, you shouldn't do that. No, you shouldn't do this. Never trump your partner's ace. You have to follow suit if you can. No, you don't have to trump. Why did you trump this time? You didn't have to trump. If the rules were a gift to us, Kim and Dan and Paige saw them as a tether, as a restraint. They simply laid out what you couldn't do. And I didn't understand why we thought these things provided us a level of freedom when it only provided them a level of confusion and frustration. I think that when you look at things like the book of Leviticus, for us when we're reading them, because we're used to enjoying things like freedoms in our lives, it's a little bit like when Kim and Paige and Dan were starting to learn to play cards in our family. When we look at all of the different rules, all of the different commandments, all 613 of them according to Jewish scholars, when we look at all the different laws in places like the book of Leviticus, we have a tendency to see them as, what do you guys think, gift or restraint? Restraint. We have a tendency to think that they have tied our hands. We have a tendency to read them sometimes and think that they are confusing, to think that they are frustrating, to think that they are difficult to get through, that they are difficult to understand. I know that that's the way we look at some of those things because we have been doing a Lenten, well, year-long discipline where we've been encouraging people on our Facebook page to go ahead and read through the entire Bible. And we just got through the book of Leviticus, and Pastor Andrea, her husband, Jeff, got through it, and after he got through reading Leviticus, you could tell that he thought the same thing that we were talking about here. He posted on our Facebook that, I just got through the book of Leviticus. That was terrible. It's because it's not our culture. It's because it can be hard to understand. It's because we view those as obscure, as not from here, as confusing, as frustrating, as restraints to us. But I want you to know that if you read through the rest of the Old Testament and you read through what the biblical writers say about the law, they say things like, the law is our joy and we meditate on it night and day. They say things like, your word is a light to my path, a lamp to my footsteps. They say things like, we have the opportunity of being able to teach these to our children and to our children's children. They say that the law of the Lord is perfect and worthy to be meditated on daily. How many of you guys think, what do you think? Did the people of Israel view this as a restraint or as a gift? They saw it the same way that my family and I saw the rules of Euchre. They saw that as a gift. We see it as our hands are tied. They saw it as beauty and wonder. So if we're going to try to figure out why they saw these things the way they saw them, you have to know a little bit of the context behind what was going on. Does anybody know where in the Bible the book of Leviticus lands? In count with me, ready? Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus. So if you're going through Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, then the book that immediately precedes Leviticus is the book of Exodus, which is the story of Israel being freed from slavery in Egypt. And so consequently, the context behind what's going on here is that the people of Israel have been bound. They have been restrained. They have been tethered. They were slaves in Egypt, and God has set them free, which is a gift. But if he is going to set them free, then they're going to have to leave from there, and they're going to have to know how to live together. They're going to have to know how to live together with each other. They're going to have to know how to live together with him, because all of the restraints have been taken off. And how many of you guys agree with me that if you just let people go in chaos, that is not a gift? And so consequently, we come across texts like the one that we have for today. And it says, "The Lord spoke to Moses, saying, speak to all the congregation of the people of Israel and say to them, you shall be holy, for I, the Lord your God, am holy." And here you need to make sure that you understand that the word holy means different. The word holy means set apart. The word holy means not the same as everybody else or everything else that's out there. And if you want to know how you are supposed to be different, if you want to know how you're supposed to be set apart, if you want to know how you're not supposed to be the same as everything, then there are instructions on that too. And it says, "When you reap the harvest of your land, you shall not reap to the very edges of your field or gather the gleanings of your harvest. You shall not strip your vineyard bare or gather the fallen grapes of your vineyard. You shall leave them for the poor and for the alien. I am the Lord your God." And so it's easy for us to read that and say, why can't you glean to the ends of your field? And it's easy for us to read that and say, why can't you gather all the grapes from your vineyard? And once again, you can understand here why context matters. Imagine a world where there's not a McDonald's every 10 miles. Imagine a world where there's not a convenience store on every corner. Imagine a world where there's no fast food or Walmart shopping centers anywhere. And imagine that you are an alien or a traveler through that country. Imagine that you've been traveling for a long time and you were not able to bring all the food that would take the entire journey for you to go. And as you are going through suddenly this land, people have left edges of the field for you to eat and grapes on the vineyard. And this land that you're going through is different than the rest of the lands that you've gone through. This land that you're going through is set apart compared to the rest of the lands that you were going through. And you begin to understand that these people care about other people, even the ones who are just traveling through, that they experience God's gift because of the way we have chosen to be set apart. Or imagine that you are a person that's not an alien, that's not a traveler, that's not an immigrant that's coming through. Imagine instead that you are a person who actually lives in Israel, but that your father has become ill, that your father has become injured, that you are somehow as a household unemployed or maybe even unemployable. And there is no community food pantry, and there is no United Harvest mobile pantry that's beginning in that area. There is no Catholic social services giving out sandwiches through the open table. And you wonder how you're going to make it, except that, you know, they didn't glean to the edges of their field. And they didn't gather every grape that was in the vineyard. And you start to understand that This not only took place for people who were traveling through, but this helped us to live together differently than most people do. I am the Lord your God, you shall be holy, for I, the Lord your God, am holy. And it says things like, you shall not steal, and you shall not deal falsely, and you shall not lie to one another, and you shall not swear falsely. How many of you guys believe along with me that if you live in a place that doesn't do that, that that is not a restraint, that that is a gift, that is a freedom? That if we know how to live together, if we know how to live with one another, if we know how to treat one another well, if we know how to be honest with one another, that this actually develops and fosters a community in which we live in. And it says, you shall not defraud your neighbor. You shall not steal. Again, same thing. You shall not keep for yourself the wages of the laborer until the morning, but instead you shall pay everyone what they are due. You shall not revile the deaf. Why shouldn't you revile the deaf? They can't hear you. But how many of you guys think that the deaf might have a father or a mother? Or a son or a daughter? Or a brother or a sister or a friend who might hear you? So you shall not put a stumbling block in front of the blind. Why shouldn't you do that? They can't see it. It might look like it's funny, but it's not. It's mean and it's cruel. And you might end up with having somebody in your family that can't see or that can't hear. Or maybe you will be the one someday. And how do you want people to treat you? Or if it's your brother or your sister or your father or your mother, how do you want them to treat them? So the answer on this is, what promotes community? What helps us live together in peace? What makes us more caring and compassionate people in the way that we end up? You could go through all of the rest of that. But the answer is, people of Israel understood that if they lived according to these laws, that it wasn't a restraint, that it was a gift. It was a gift in helping them live together with one another. How many of you guys think that in our world today, in our community, in our nation, maybe we could use a few more rules in the way that we talk with one another, in the way that we relate to one another, so that the communication we have would promote community rather than tear it down. So that the rules we have would promote relationships rather than tear them apart. See, if you think that that's true, because I did, I think we need a little bit more of that today, then maybe with as confusing, maybe with as frustrating as things like the book of Leviticus are, maybe it would be a good idea if we did read them again. Because if it's going to be a world where we can promote relationships, where we can promote civility, where we can promote community again, then how many of y'all are with me? You want to be dealt in? Congregation, may rise.
Thank you. I believe in God, Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended to heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, communion of saints, forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Please be seated for the offering.
Thank you.
Let us pray for God's justice, peace, and healing. I will end each petition with glory in your mercy. Please respond, hear our prayer. Make the church in every land holy as you are holy, O God. Join the voices of rich and poor, young and old, friends and enemies, in praise of you. Orchestrate harmony among us. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We pray for clean air, clean water, and clean soil. Renew the sky, land, and waterways. Teach us how to care for the earth as you desire. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We pray for an end to war and for peace throughout the world. Prosper the work of peacemakers. Erase hatred and stop violence. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We pray for all who live with cognitive disorders or eating disorders. Provide them with supportive communities. Restore the forgotten. Comfort the mourning. Heal the hurting, especially Gerald Morlang, Lance Hyen, Milton Burrell, Kevin Klatt, and Sherry Corgan. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We pray for all who are discerning a call to ministry and those who accompany them. Empower them with your grace and wisdom to continue building on the foundation of faith we have in Jesus Christ. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We give thanks for the faithful departed, especially Sherry Merman's son, Josh Roth, and Alan Hoyt's brother, Jerry Hoyt. And we pray for those who will die today. Hold them in your loving embrace. Breathe your spirit of peace into them. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Receive these prayers in the name of Christ, the light of the world, who is one with you and the Holy Spirit, now and forever. Amen. Please join me in the Lord's Prayer.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses,